I wonder if we would be surprised at how many committed Christian couples speak to one another that way. I'm talking Christian couples in this room. A few years ago, the New York Times reported on a major study that tracked 2,000 couples that got married and stayed married over a matter of 15 years. And the article reported that basically newlyweds enjoy a big happiness boost that lasts for about 2 years in their relationship, and then that special joy wears off. And Christian author Gary Thomas illustrates this by talking about the hourglass. Every marriage has an hourglass, he says, and the moment you become smitten by someone, the second you find yourself deeply in love, is the moment that hourglass gets turned over. And there was enough sand in that hourglass, he believes, on average to last you about 12 to 18 months. And on occasion, the sand may trickle down a little bit beyond that, up to about 2 years, but never by much and not with the same intensity. The average lifespan of infatuation is almost always less than 2 years. Now, wouldn't you agree that we didn't need some study to tell us that? That basically, when you first get married, you're super crazy about each other, and over time, those feelings eventually wear down, and they eventually, hopefully, go into a deeper, mature kind of love with occasionally fits and spurts of those kinds of emotions, but by and large, after 2 years, it sort of wears down. Everyone knows that the glow of a new marriage fades pretty quick, and couples eventually have to get down to the hard work of marriage. But what exactly is that hard work? I love this interview I was reading about the actor Jeff Bridges, and someone asked him to identify his worst character defect. Now, if someone asked you for you to identify your worst character defect, what would it be? Lean over to the person next to you really fast. Share it. For most of you, it's pride. You don't want to share your worst character defect. I wouldn't either. I'm glad you didn't ask me to share that question, right? But Bridges has asked this question, and he thought about it for a second, and then he answered, not loving enough. Not having enough compassion, empathy, wisdom. My wife and I have been married for 36 years, and I'm deeply in love with her, but every once in a while, we get into what I refer to as our deep ancient battle. It's always very elusive, and it's hard to find the real kernel of it, but basically, it's about this. You don't get it. You don't get what it's like to be me. Neither of us really understands what it's like to be that other person. Now, the fact is, every single person that is married here will attest that after a couple's glow wears off, you will quickly settle down to one, two, or three recurring issues that come up over and over and over again. And without a tremendous amount of hard work and patience, they never go away. Now, that doesn't mean there's anything unique or terrible about the couples that are in this room that have these ancient battles. As long as people get married, when two people come together with their own unique personalities, their own worldviews, and their family of origin issues, their private wounds, doubt, insecurities, and addictions, every couple in this room will have its handful of battles that they're destined to fight together. Now, eventually, once these are identified, every couple in this room can be classified in three categories, in one of three ways. And it all relates to how we go about fighting. The first group that's in this room are those who are headed for divorce, period. Do not pass go, do not collect $200, you're done. You're married and you know it's just a matter of time and you're waiting till you have enough money, you're at a certain point in the future, like when your kids move out, you're just putting in your time. There are a number of people that are in these shoes, and I just want to comment, there are a number of people here in this congregation that were in your shoes that were able to turn that around. Now, the second group in the room, there are people here this morning that are married and they simply cohabitate together. You raise the kids, yes. Yes, you have sex occasionally. You even enjoy one another's company from time to time, but you have exchanged intimacy for functionality. You are two co-parents existing as roommates. And there are issues that you just avoid that are like elephants in the room, and you have been living like that for years, and you just assume that this is normal. It's not normal. Now, your marriage reminds you of that great line from the Eagles song. I say that, man, I miss Glenn Frey. That great Eagles song. We are all prisoners here of our own device. Now, a few years ago, we did a survey of married couples in our church, and we asked people, completely anonymous, we need you to answer these questions. And we had great results, great participation. So we asked this question, look on the screen with me. If you could do it all over again, would you marry your spouse? The absolute vast majority of people said yes, but 13% said no. Now, what I want to point out is, when it comes to surveys, Christians lie. They're terrible liars. There's an answership bias that demographers, when they do research, they know that if you're expected to give a moral answer, even if you know, like, we're not tracing, you know, who's giving this particular response, people will fudge on the numbers. More than likely, when it comes to that bias, you can double the number, sometimes triple the number. But let's just work with the 13%. That represents 13% of the couples. For every 10 couples in this room, that are one that are sitting here this morning, and they're like, I gotta be honest, I wish I could have checked out years ago, but I can't. Now, the good news is there is a third group in this room, okay? And it's those who are addressing their deep ancient battles with kindness. These people started out with just as many issues as the first two. Reminds me of that great Jack Johnson song, Broken. When, you know, without you, I was broken, but I'd rather be broke down with you by my side. Just as many disadvantages, just as many feelings of questioning whether or not we've married the right person. Couples that started out just like the other two groups, but unlike the other two, found a way to understand and appropriate the passage that we're going to look at this morning. The passage I want to talk about today is Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. It's in your Bible app. If you're here today for the first time, you should have received a Bible on your way in. That's our church's gift to you. You can find it in Galatians. Just start in the book of Matthew and keep going. You'll eventually find it. The book of Galatians, in this context, is not specifically addressing the issue of marriage, but it's addressing the issue of relationships, which is, I think, the best place to start when it comes to marriage. I think the worst groups to go to if you have marriage issues are marriage groups. I think that you need to start out at a more foundational level. Anyway, the Apostle Paul had started a number of churches in ancient Turkey, and then he wrote this letter that was meant to be distributed and passed around to these different churches to address what was going on in there. I'd like to read this in light of marriage, and you'll see why. The Apostle Paul says in chapter 5, verse 13, "You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command," just one command, "love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other." Now, when you read that, I want to just highlight just three words that sort of stand out in stark relief to the rest of them. The first is freedom. You and I, when we get married, there's no marriage police. There's no one, as you get into an argument and is sitting there in the background, you know, and you get overly aggressive or use some hurtful words or she's, and they're like, oh, they throw a flag in the middle of the family room. Come over. Time out now. Now, let's rephrase this right now. What could you have said? There's no one doing that. You have the freedom to turn around and sleep with as many people on the planet as you want to, or you can be faithful. You can spend your money however you want. You can do whatever you want to do because you are two consenting adults and the laws allow you the ability to do that. You are the master of your own fate. There is complete, total freedom in your relationship to do whatever you want to do. Now, the second word that is interesting about that is in verse 13, it says, flesh. Do not use your freedom to indulge your flesh. Now, lean over to the person next to you and sort of pinch their skin. if they're introverts, they'll just love this. They just love this. So you pinch their skin, right? The Apostle Paul's not talking about your actual flesh. Using a Greek word, sarkos, an ancient Greek word, but basically the old NIV translation translated it sinful nature. And basically it's that base part of us that gives us a proclivity to disobey God and hurt ourselves and other people. And what the Apostle Paul is saying is, listen, do not give free expression to that part of you, that base part of you, the flesh. Don't let it go untethered. And you know what? Don't use the "I don't have marriage police in the house" to yell and to critique one another and to belittle one another and embarrass one another and throw up the past and hit below the belt. See, the question isn't whether or not your marriage has its deep ancient battles. The question is, have you committed that you will not address your spouse in a way that is unbecoming? A number of years ago, someone was criticizing me in our church, and other pastors will do this time to time. It's usually because of our emphasis on evangelism. Sometimes it's because we have women in leadership. It's funny. The Christian community is the only community in the world, I think, other than politics, that puts up with bullies. And this guy was saying stuff. So you know me and my very gentle, sort of hesitant personality. I called him up and completely unloaded on him. Someone was telling me that you said this. Did you? Yeah, I said this. And I just went nuts on that guy. Well, we have a mutual friend in common. And this guy that I completely lambasted essentially told our mutual friend. This mutual friend is a friend of mine, a mentor, a longtime friend of mine. And he said, "Brian, you know, you were right in what you did. He was wrong in what he said." He said, "But my wife and I have a phrase that we use in our marriage that when we do something that is out of character for who we are at this stage in life, how old we are, we will simply say, 'You know, when you said that and you attacked me that way, that was unbecoming of who you are.'" And he said, "Brian, that was unbecoming of you and your position. You didn't need to handle it that way." I think that's a good phrase that we ought to think about when it comes to our relationship. Listen, I know you're angry, but you're 32 years old, and how you completely flipped out, or how those words that you used, or how you dug up the past was so unbecoming of a person of your age and your stature. There are just a lot of us in this room, if we are honest, act a whole lot like that video that we were watching. Now, maybe your problem isn't explosive behavior or words. Maybe it's manipulation. Maybe it's silence. Maybe it's passive-aggressive behavior. We all do things that are unbecoming when it comes to conflict resolution. And the Apostle Paul says, just because you're free, don't use your freedom to indulge that sinful part of you. You know what I love hearing stories about how people get proposed to. I've never shared the way Lisa and I, the way I asked her to marry me. I shared with you the first week. I was talking to people who weren't married, who were singles. We talked about the four C's. Do you remember the four C's? What are the four things that have to be in place before you say "I do" to someone that you love? There has to be character, the competence, chemistry, Christian, and what's the last one? Calling. Right, you have to feel like there's a lot of people that can meet those criteria. Am I being called to that? So anyway, I found Lisa. We had these four things in common, and I was going to ask her to marry me, but we were in college at the time, and I was broke, and so I needed to earn enough money, and so I became the school breakfast cook. Now, I learned basically. I'm not very good at it, but I was broke. So I got up at 4:30 in the morning, every single morning, Monday through Saturday, and I made some extra money, essentially cooking breakfast for people in the school. I was the line cook, cooking, and I was actually giving people too many eggs, and the pancakes were huge. They loved it, but I was evidently terrible at it, so they relieved me of my duties after about 2 months. But I made enough money. In addition to that, the school basically would have churches call if their pastors got sick and couldn't preach. So it was, I had like the bat phone, you know, I got a call Saturday night. Okay, there's this church, and I would drive like 5 hours away early on a Sunday morning, and I would go and I would speak, and they would give me $100. I was like, I'm rich. $100, right? And eventually I got enough money to bought a ring, and I went over to Lisa's house and asked her mom for Lisa's hand in marriage. Her father wasn't involved in her life, and so I sat down with her mom, and lo and behold, I thought this was going to be a snap, like I'm the prince in shining armor showing up. Oh no, man, she grilled me. How are you going to take care of my daughter? I mean, she has had some brilliant questions to ask me. She was ready for this. So eventually, I won her over to giving me her blessing. And a couple months later, I was speaking at a church where I did an internship in Lancaster, Ohio. And I said, will you come with me? Because I'm really nervous. There's going to be a lot of people there. And so she agreed, and we showed up. I spoke. And I had this Bible. Some of you are used to using like paperback Bibles. I had bought a Bible, a leather-bound Bible that I carried with me. Did anybody have that? Like, this meant a lot to me. So anyway, I worked it out, so I left it on the front pew. And we drove like 20 minutes to 30 minutes down the road, and then I acted like I forgot my Bible. I'm freaking out, oh my gosh, can't believe, where's my Bible in the car? Can't find it anywhere. So we drove back, we got to the church, they left it open for me, and we walked in, and I wanted to ask her to marry me on the front row of church, because I wanted that, like, to set the tone for our relationship. So I got down on one knee, and she got emotional, I got emotional, and then I asked her to marry me, and then we both got down on our knees, and we prayed that God would bless our marriage and our ministry and our lives together. So I love hearing your stories. I love how creative, and there's so much pressure on guys now to come up with these like crazy, you know, flash mob video sort of things. But I love hearing these stories. Now here's what I've learned. Every single engagement in the start of a marriage is unique. Everyone does it differently. Everyone has their unique story when it comes to how their marriage starts. But I have learned, in over a quarter century being a pastor, every couple whose relationship disintegrates, it happens in exactly the same way. All couples start out differently, but they all, if they disintegrate, the relationship ends the same way. Let me tell you why. Psychologist Cliff Notarius of the Catholic University of America and Howard Markham of the University of Denver discovered in their studies that the typical factors that you might think in terms of a successful relationship, what enables that would be different, he's found. He said, the couples that make it are not, they don't, basically at the beginning, it's not how much on love they are, how much affection that they exchange, or whether or not they fight. He said, in fact, the research has proven out the couples who endure and couples that don't endure look almost exactly the same in the beginning days. When Notarius and Markham studied newlyweds over the first decade of marriage, they found a subtle difference. They found this. Among couples who would ultimately stay together, on average, 5 out of 100 comments made about each other were put downs. Among the couples who would later divorce, roughly about 10 out of every 100 comments were insults. And that gap magnified over the following decade until couples were flinging 5 times as many cruel and invalidating comments at each other as happy couples. The researchers commented that hostile put-downs act as cancerous cells that, if unchecked, erode the relationship over time, and in the end, relentless, unremitting negativity takes control, and the couple can't get through a week without major blow-ups. This is essentially what the Apostle Paul is warning about. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. You can treat each other however you want, but don't use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. Serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command. Love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out or you will be destroyed by each other. And that's the third word I want to point out, the word destroyed. It means to completely empty, like draining a bank account of all of its funds. If you constantly nitpick each other, there will be nothing left. In fact, when I talk to people, what happened? There was just nothing left. So let me ask you this question. Are you willing to serve your spouse? Like serve your spouse. Gordon McDonald said one time, you know if you're a servant if people treat you like a servant. Like doulos, slave in the New Testament nomenclature was an actual slave that went around. It was normal to wash feet and clean stuff and pick up stuff. We did a survey a number of years ago, the one I referred to. We asked this question, and it was this. What is the number one thing that you and your spouse argue about? Now, do these results surprise you? These are people in this church about 5 years ago. The number one thing is money. Finding about money problems. People occasionally, these are people who don't give, they will say, they'll criticize me for not, or for talking about money too much. And I'm like, here's the little secret. I don't talk about money. I talk about marriage. I just use money as the tool to talk about marriage. Okay? Second, household duties. The second biggest thing that people fight about in this church, in their marriage. If you're sitting next to your husband, please lean over right now and elbow them in a gut. Can you do that really fast? This week, you are going to plan the meals. This week, you are going to cook. This week, you are going to the grocery store. This week, you are going to clean the dishes every single night. This week, you are going to do all the grocery shopping. You're going to do all the laundry. You're going to clean the house. You're going to do the checking. You're going to do everything. Women in this room work on average, when their jobs and household responsibilities are taken into consideration, 15 more hours a week than the men in this room. And so, guys, your wives have permission, right, to get all ugly with you this week, okay? And so I just want to say, stop it. Now, I do everything in our house that I just mentioned. And every single thing that I just mentioned, I do that. And then I work a lot. Now, I want to pause here and say, Lisa will tell me after church, I hate it when you say that because I'm in a doctoral program. There's a reason you're doing that. And I did that for the first 23 years of our relationship. You make yourself sound like you're all awesome and everything. I did this for 23 straight years and you didn't do jack around the house, right? But it was an eye-opener. And so my question to you is, how much are you dumping on your spouse? There's a reason they're resentful and angry. They're exhausted, absolutely, utterly exhausted. It's not fair. And so my question, going back to this passage, is are you willing to serve your wife? Issues with kids, actually sex, got before that one. Right, we talked about that last week. Issues with kids, in-laws, and it goes down from there. As Tim Keller, brilliant thinker and writer and pastor, he wrote, over the years, you're going to go through seasons in which you have to learn to love a person you didn't marry, who was something of a stranger. You will have to make changes that you don't want to make, and so will your spouse. The journey may eventually take you into a strong, tender, joyful marriage, but it is not because you married the perfectly compatible person. That person doesn't exist. And so I'm going to give you a couple challenges. The first challenge I'm going to give you is I want you to have a very honest conversation with yourself. What behaviors do you need to change about yourself? those of you who aren't married, who are thinking about getting married, what changes do you need to change in order to bring it into a new relationship? Let me just, a little side note here, we have a baptism service next week, and we are asking those of you who are ready to make Jesus the leader and the forgiver of your life to show up and be a part of that. I can tell you, and maybe I'm the only person in the world that has felt this way. Lisa and I have been in arguments before when I was being a complete, total butthole. Just total jerk. And I use butthole because I would like to use a harsher word, but I can't. Just a jerk. And the only thing that enabled me to pause, recognize my words or my actions or whatever, is I believe the presence of the Holy Spirit in my life, quickening my heart and saying, hey, idiot, this is your bride here. You don't speak disrespectfully to her. Now, there are a lot of people, roughly probably a third of the people in the room aren't Christians here. And I just want to say here, no matter how good you think your relationship is right now, not being a Christian, there is a complete whole nother world that will exist in your relationship if you're willing to make Jesus the leader and the forgiver of your life. But it begins with humbling yourself. And so my question is if you truly want to make this marriage work, you're not going to be able to do it on your own. Very few people can find a mutually satisfying relationship without the presence of the Holy Spirit in their lives. I would love for you to take that step. So there's a card in your program, a baptism, a response card. And if you're like, hey, I'm in, I want you to fill that out before the service is over. I want you to fold it in half, and on the way out, I want you to put it in the bowls. Here's the second thing that I want you to do. I want you to have an honest conversation with your spouse this week about the ground rules for communication and how you're going to resolve conflict. Don't be defensive. Don't get into an argument about how you're going to handle arguments. You know, this whole series has been, I've heard from a lot of people, a kickstart for a lot of people, a reminder for others. And what we wanted to do is we wanted to conclude this service and this whole series by taking a moment of reflection. So I want to ask every single person in the room, do not move during what is about to happen next. While our band is singing, I want you to simply to reflect, for those of you who are single, over the kind of person that you want to marry, over the kind of person that you want to be. I want you to reflect on the issues, for those of you that are married, about that we've been talking about. And I want you to ask the Holy Spirit to quicken your heart and move in your heart and to make you sensitive and aware of the things that He would like for you to work on.
What do you think about when you look at me? I know I'm not the fairy tale you dreamed we'd be. You wore the veil, you walked the aisle, you took my hand, and we dove into a mystery. Simpler times, before all our scars and all our secrets begin to lie. And now on this hallowed ground we draw the battle lines. We'll make it through the night. It's gonna take much more than promises this time. Only God can change our minds. Maybe you and I were never meant to be complete. Can we just be broken together? If you can bring your shattered dreams and I'll bring mine, could healing still be there? and how it must have been so lonely by my side. We were building kingdoms and chasing dreams and left love behind. I'm praying God will help our broken hearts alive, and we won't give up the fight. It's gonna take much more than promises this time. Only God can change our minds. Maybe you and I were never meant to be complete. Could we just be broken together? If you can bring your shattered dreams and I'll bring feeling still be smoking and save us. The only way we'll last forever is broken together. Maybe you and I were never meant to be complete. Could we just be broken together? If you could bring your shattered dreams and I'll bring mine, could healing still be spoken and saved?